I love finding out where my boards end up. I had an email the other day from a bloke in Taiwan who ended up with one of my Origin boards, this 6-0 black fish that I made for like...
Hello and welcome to the UK Surf Show. We are your hosts. I'm Pete.
And I'm Dom.
Oh, and why am I with Dom?
I don't know. Why are you here, Pete?
Because I just picked up a new board, baby.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, before we get into this one, we'll go on all about the board and what Dom's been up to and everything. Your discount codes for North Core. 15% off anything you order at North Core. And if you use the discount code SSPODCAST15, all one word, and that will get you 15% off anything you order. That is valid till the 30th of September. After the 30th of September, it is UK Surf Show 15. And then also, if you head across to Surface Wetsuits, that's spelled SRFACE, and use the discount code the UK Surf Show 10, all one word, and that will get you 10% off anything you order from Surface Wetsuits. Look at that, like a pro, eh?
Like a pro.
yeah. So I'm here at Origin on a Friday afternoon, and I've just picked up a beautiful, beautiful new board, and. Tell us what you did, mate.
Yeah. What I did was I made you a surfboard.
It's quite nice, mate. It's quite nice. It's pretty, very nice, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. So for any listeners that are missing Pete spotting at the beach, instead
in a bright red and black board.
Bright red and black board, yeah. This one's blue with some black streaks on the bottom. So
yeah, I'm going to spray paint it when I get home.
Don't
so no
you
one
dare.
It.
Don't you dare. Well, I guess following a conversation which we didn't record about what you were looking for from your new board.
So if you hadn't listened to the episode before, Dom made me a board originally, which was lovely, by the way, but I decided to give it away after we went to Surfability. Me and Leighton went there, and we were affected by it so much, we wanted to do something, so we gave it away in a raffle. It made us shed loads of money for them, which was great. I had a conversation with you before and said, look, this is what I want to do, and you were like, do it, and we'll make another one. And, you know, made a couple of changes as well, because the way I was surfing may have changed. I may have got better. I may have got worse.
Yeah, I mean, when you approached me about it, I was just immediately into it. You know, it's such a great organization. Yeah. And I think it's such a great initiative that you took as well to just sort of off your own bat, raising some funds for them. So it's, yeah, I've got a lot of respect for that, a lot of time for that, and wanted to support it. So
yeah, cheers. So, yeah, what did we do? What did we do? Well, right. What did you do? I did fuck all.
Well, you texted me every week. Is it done yet? Is it done yet?
I didn't text you every week. If I text you every week, I'd have been skint on phone bills because it's been that long. It's been cheaper to phone a premium rate number, to be honest.
Yeah, that's a service that we no longer offer, Pete. So, it has been a long time, and I do apologize for that. It's, I mean, Pete knows, but the listeners probably don't. Some might, I don't know. So I got struck down by the
C word.
The C word.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was funny, actually. We went to Portugal for a family trip, and both my wife and I got it while we were there. And she recovered super quickly from it, but yeah. the disease itself was more impactful. For me, I hardly felt like I had anything until afterwards.
Yeah.
Absolutely smashed me, and I didn't work for nearly 5 weeks.
Yeah, so I let you off for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's all right. We are recording this one in the workshop.
In the workshop.
With people coming in, and so if there's any breaks and cuts or anything, it'll be because someone's come in for... Can you repair my board, please? I need it tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, that's cool. So, yeah, you got struck down with that. I mean, I think I had it as well. Even though my test came back negative, I was done for months afterwards.
Yeah,
I had no energy. It was awful. So I let you off for the amount of time. And to be honest, I let you off because you have done me a really good deal. We won't say how good a deal you got me. I think, personally, it should be free for the amount of times that I've had to wait for it, but... Because
it was entitled to an opinion, Pete. That's
because fine. It was doing it for the charity thing and everything like that. You've done me a kindness.
Yeah. No, like I said, I wanted to support it as much as I could. So.
Yeah, and I mean, like I said, the last board. I loved the last board. Like I loved the design of it. I loved how it was when I was locking into waves. When I locked into a wave on it, it just felt like the wave just grabbed hold of it.
Yeah.
And it was really stiff and like it was just in there. You know what I mean? It was really good. The only problem I had with it, when we compared it to my other one, my blue one that I surfed, which is a piece of junk, but I surfed really well on it, was the volume.
Yeah.
And I think that's more down to me in talking about it before that I should have said, I want more volume.
Sure.
And I listened back to the episode and at no point do I say, I want more volume.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things, you know, it's always a journey. I think trying out different stuff and, I mean, even with all possible information, like it's personal preference as well. So, you know, it's part of the deal. I think anyone who's surfed for any amount of time knows that, you know, sometimes you get on the board that's going to, you know, you think it's going to be the perfect thing for you. And for whatever reason, it's just not quite delivering what you want.
Yeah.
So it's just a matter of trying different stuff.
Yeah. I mean, like as volume wise goes to it, I think when I surfed on my blue board, I would say I paddled for 10 waves. I'd probably catch 8 of them.
Yeah.
And on the red one, that was down to about 6.
Yeah.
So it was, and the only thing I can put it down to is volume, because everyone else that had a go on it was
loved
like,
it.
Fucking hell, this is amazing. This is like a McTavish crossed with a, I can't remember what my mate said it was, but he loves McTavishes.
And
he said it rode like a McTavish.
Amazing.
And Leighton loved it.
Yeah.
Only probably because it wasn't broken like his.
Yeah. I fixed that though.
Yeah, I know.
But you rode Leighton's as well, didn't you?
So Leighton's was slightly different to mine, wasn't it? Slightly wider, and I could catch straight away on Leighton's and everything.
So Leighton's, the biggest difference between yours and Leighton's was that yours was a bit more refined.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess following that conversation we had about the way you wanted it to ride, we went for a more refined design on that. And, you know, the byproduct of that is that it, you know, had a little less volume and was probably a slightly less forgiving shape.
Yeah.
It's interesting because the differences weren't enormous.
Yeah, because when we compared the dimension of the blue board and the red and black one, they weren't that different. It was literally just volume.
The overall dimensions were really similar, but the difference in volume was like 30 litres or something ridiculous.
Yeah. So that's like, we were talking about this earlier, like it's one of those things that people go like, oh, volume doesn't matter and blah, blah, blah. It fucking does.
Yeah.
It really does.
I mean, it's one of those things. It does matter in the way that it all matters.
Yeah.
But none of it matters in isolation.
Yeah.
You know, so I think when people get into trouble with volume, it's when they talk in absolute terms.
Yeah.
Different. It's not as simple as I need 42 litres or I need 80 litres or 32 or whatever it is.
600.
Like, 600, fine. Enjoy your sup.
Yeah. I'm not a small guy. That's the thing, though. You know, I'm not.
You're doing yourself a disservice, mate.
No, I'm big built anyway. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like. Yeah. Like, I don't know, my wife always says, you know, you've got really like broad shoulders and you're not like small built. So you've got to take that into account.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat as well. Well, my summer weight's about 105 kilo. My winter weight's more than that.
You're talking Australian again, aren't you? Oh, it's fucking foreign languages. What can you do? I don't know what I am. I literally still haven't weighed myself ever.
Oh, really?
Scared of the scales.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
But so, I mean, volume matters definitely, but it's all relative to the length and width and the overall shape of the board and how it works, and it's not as simple as a number, unfortunately.
Yeah, because I mean, when I came back to you afterwards and said, right, I like this and I like this out of both boards, and it's like it's something to compare with. I don't know, is that a difficult thing that you find, like someone goes, I want to get a custom board done and it's going to be perfect and I'm going to surf amazing on it. And then they go out on it and they're like, well, actually, it's not doing what I want. Maybe not because it's not doing what they want, but they haven't got the ability to make it do what they want.
Yeah, I mean, and that is sometimes a part of it. Yeah. It's also, I mean, you talk about characteristics of of a board, and like a lot of people say things like, oh, I want it to be more drivey through turns or more pivoty or faster down the line. Well, faster than what? More pivoty than what? Yeah. You know, like it's all relative to your experience, and everyone has a different journey with this stuff.
Yeah.
Everyone rides different stuff, different boards in different conditions in a different way.
Yeah.
And definitely the input of the surf is a massive factor in that. So, I mean, I guess it's just a point that there's no absolutes with any of this stuff. And I think, you know, if you view it as a destination, you're stuffed from the beginning.
Yeah.
It's not like that. It's a journey. It's an experience. And
yeah,
you just got to try stuff.
Yeah, because
you'll find out what works for you.
I've said, like, before, like, I've, you know, grown up with skateboarding most of my life and stuff like that. And it's a similar sort of thing, you know, like a little half inch here and there can make a massive difference on what you can do on a board. And don't look at me like that.
What do you mean, Pete?
Yeah, but like a little bit. I'm not going there. I'm not even going to take the bait and go there. It's you know, little differences can make such a difference on what your board can do. And I think I've got that same thing. Like people were saying to me, "Oh my God, how can you give away your board? It's so nice and blah blah blah."
Yeah.
But I said that because I've grown up skateboarding, and I used to go at one point. I was going through a board a month, basically.
Yeah.
Just a board.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
it's a tool.
Yeah, yeah, it's a tool to do it, and you can get another one if you know, and then you can change things. And you know, I suppose the advantage and disadvantage, if you buy one off the shelf, they've got something that works all round for people, and every single one of them's the same because they're doing it machine, bang, 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 bang. Whereas if you go to a shaper, you can go, I like this, 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 and this, and you can get them all and smudge them together and try and come up with something in between.
Right, you can go down that path, and it also means if you've got a relationship with that person who's building the boards, you can give that feedback and make those tiny adjustments that make a massive difference to how it rides. You know?
Yeah.
As it turns out, what we decided to do was quite a big adjustment.
Yeah.
We've actually started with a different template on this one.
Yeah.
Coming back to what your board is. We've done you a it's a new model for Origin called the Transatlantic. It's not on the website as of today. It might be by the time this goes out.
No pressure.
Probably won't be, but you can always contact me directly.
Hit you up on the Instagram or something.
Yeah, absolutely.
And give it 5 months and he'll reply to you.
Yeah, oh, come on, mate.
No, he's a busy man, you know.
I am a busy man. Good people of southwest of Britain are keeping me very busy, which I'm incredibly grateful for. I'm definitely not moaning. But so with your board, we went for the Transatlantic, which is it's a much more traditional approach to a longboard.
Yeah.
So more parallel rails on the outline, I'd say, would be the best way to describe it.
Yeah.
There's a lot more width through the tail than on the Calicat, and it's really designed to paddle easily, take off early, get down the line really easily, really nice in trim, and to nose ride well.
Yeah. It looks bloody lovely. I'll put pictures on with this episode. I'll put them on the Instagram, and I'll put pictures on the... I'll do a little YouTube video with this one and just... put bits and pieces, and there'll be some little bonus content on that as well, because we filmed me coming in and getting the board as well, so that'll be on there. So check out the YouTube and make sure you subscribe to that, and you can see the board in the real
on the tube.
Yeah, but it is a thing of bloody beauty yet again. You've done, like, I haven't seen a board you've produced yet and I've gone, yeah, that's all right, you know, that's a bit fucking mingy, I wouldn't choose that color. All of the boards I've seen you do, I'm like, fucking hell, that's nice. That's not, like, literally could just go, I want that, I want that. I'm just going to remortgage, love, a minute. Hold on. Why? How come? I just bought 47 boards off of Dom. all of them are lovely, even down to, like, so I was saying about, like, I really want to try and learn to, like, ride a fish. And that's the thing, because I see it's like a shortboard, but it's got loads more volume in it. And I've come to the conclusion, I need volume. That's it. I just need volume in a board. I tried one of the MF boards at the Wave, and the thing was so buoyant. That was the best surf I've had at the Wave. I caught everything on that.
Yeah.
And, you know, you said you've got like a fish one out there, but I think it's something like that, I think, is worth. With a place like the Wave, you can go there and try it, try all these different boards out, and then go, right, that's what I like.
Yeah.
Like, if someone was having a board made by you, you could go to the Wave, like, try bloody 20 different boards out. Fucking expensive to do it, but you can try 20 different boards out and then go, right, I like this, 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 and this.
Yeah.
Make me something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, that's something I do quite a lot here as well. I mean, I've got one of everything, like all of my models waxed up, ready to go, and quite regularly lend them to customers to try out.
Yeah.
And they quite often take it down the way because it's such a good way to try boards.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think it just kind of comes back to that point. Just try stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I think going with preconceptions of what you want, or more than that, what you need.
Yeah.
Is always fraught with danger. I think you just got to try stuff, be open-minded and see what works for you.
I think as well, that's something that can only be discovered by actually going on that journey yourself and 100%. Doing it. Because it's all very well, like you saying, or me saying, or anyone saying, you've got to try these things and do them. And you go, no, I like this. That's what I like, blah, blah, blah. I know what I want. But until you've tried it, or you don't know what you want, you really don't.
Exactly. Yeah.
So that's my board.
Yeah.
Which is bloody fantastic. I can't wait to ride it. And as I said, this was at the time of recording, this Sunday, there's supposed to be some surf. And if I ever get to finish work, like real life work, not fun podcast stuff, it'd be really good if someone would like just sponsor the show or buy the show to the point where I could just go surfing and talk about it all the time. I'd love that.
Well, Rupert Murdoch, if you're listening.
No.
No? No, it wouldn't work for Murdoch.
Oh, I nearly dropped the C-bomb. Anyway, yeah, no, maybe not someone like that big, but, you know. Oh, I forgot what I was going to say now. I've gone off on one. But, yeah, there's supposed to be waves this Sunday. And I was saying, if I can ever get out of bloody work, because I've got so much of it on at the moment, hopefully I'll be going down Sunday and I won't have to work Sunday. And I will get to try out my new board.
Amazing.
I might have to tap up Logfin Co, though, because I need a new fin now, because he sent me a red one before.
Oh, right. But, you know, the board can't tell what colour the fin is. Like, but still I work. Can.
Aesthetically, it will not look right. Like, if you put a red fin on a blue board, it's not going to look right.
Well, you never know, mate. No, just try stuff.
No, not the red fin. It's a lovely fin, though. Yeah. So what else have you been up to, anyway, apart from getting COVID and...
Yeah. What else? I mean, work has been pretty mental. I think since we last spoke, what's that, 18 months ago?
We went for a surf together, didn't we, as well?
Oh, we did. That was ages ago.
That was like beginning of the year.
Yeah.
Because that was still in winter suits then.
Was that, Saunton?
Yeah, it's got to be like March or something like that.
Yeah.
Because I saw you first wave, I saw you.
Yeah.
And then you caught a right. I caught a right, and my right lasted ages. Yeah. And by the time I got off my right, I was halfway down the beach. I was like, I'm not fucking paddling back.
Yeah, I didn't see
there.
You again. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't see you till I got out.
Yeah. That was a good session. That was good fun.
Yeah. Some fun waves that day.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, I did have a little break from surfing, obviously, because I was ill, but I've been surfing quite a bit lately.
Cheers for the invite.
What's that?
Cheers for the invite.
Ah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that awkwardness was definitely there. Yeah, that wasn't staged at all. Right, well, moving on.
Yeah.
I've been surfing with all my mates. All the guys I really love spending time with.
Yeah, great. Cheers, mate. Yeah. I like the fact that I spoke to you and I was like, oh, yeah, cheers for the invite. Oh, shit, mate. Sorry, I didn't even think to ring you.
Yeah, didn't ever cross my mind, not for a second.
Yeah. Brilliant. Cheers. That's what I do when I... tell people about surfboards they should get. You don't even cross my mind, mate.
Yeah. Surfboards? Oh, yeah, Skin Dog.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's where you want to go.
Sorry, Pete.
Yeah, great.
But no, I have been surfing quite a bit. It's been great fun. So I've got a trip coming up to Morocco.
Nice. Whereabouts you going?
In October. So I'm basically tagging along to an existing trip that a group of guys are going on. They very kindly invited me along, and they've got it dialed. So. Yeah. I think we're staying near Imswam.
Nice.
But they've sorted accommodation and a surf guide and stuff. So basically it's going to be that as home base. Then we'll go off each day on strike missions and
nice.
Try and get some waves.
Sounds amazing.
Yeah.
You've got to get some GoPro footage of that.
Well, you know what? I'm going to try. The thing is, I'm really bad with that. Like whenever I try and film myself surfing, I'm so busy messing around with the bloody camera.
Yeah, I've had the same thing.
And I just, it's a lot less fun. I've got a lot of respect for you know, the guys that get out there and do that and can perform, because I can't.
No, it's terrible. It's like, as soon as you put a camera on the board or have it with you, it's like it's just something else to like worry about, and you end up just having this shit surf.
Yeah, it's so true. And I mean, the best footage I've had with a GoPro is from a mouth mount.
Yeah,
which I really really like. You get that super smooth footage, and it's a great point of view shot.
Yeah,
but then you're just messing around with it constantly, aren't you?
Yeah, that's it.
Anyway, I will.
You need to start up a business where you go out and you just film people in the water, you know? And like...
What, like a man with a camera?
Yeah.
Like a cameraman?
Yeah.
I wonder if anyone's ever tried that.
I don't know if anyone's ever thought of it.
There could be money in that, you know?
It could be.
Yeah.
I don't know why there's not more of them, though, that are like at the spots where... I know there's people that go there. You see them on Instagram. People go to certain spots and they take photos all the time and like videos and stuff. But like... Start up a business. Someone do it out there. Start up a business and go, right, we'll film you. There's someone will probably go down, actually, there is one, and they're called blah, blah, blah. But I've never heard of them.
Well, hey, pop a link.
Yeah. Tell us who they are and we'll speak to them. Because, like, you want that business of, like, someone going, right, I'm going surfing with a load of mates. Let's pay this guy. He'll come out in the water, take photos from the shore, whatever, to video.
Yeah.
While I'm out there. It's a bloody great idea.
That is a great idea. Yeah, well, there you go. If it isn't out there and you're listening and you're handy with a camera, do it.
Yeah, do it.
Yeah.
So you're off to Morocco.
So
how long are you there for?
Should be good. There for a week. Do you know, one of the guys coming on the trip is Noah from Valimo.
Yeah.
He got super excited about it when I told him about it and wangled his way into the group as well.
He's not like him to get super excited about anything, is
mate,
he?
He is the most excited bloke I've ever met in my life.
When Ben Gravy was at the wave, Noah sent me a message. Is he still there? I was like, yeah, he's still there. He got a picture a bit later that day of him with Ben Gravy, and he's like, I proper fanboyed out. well excited.
I've got a story from the other side of that interaction, but we'll come back to that. But yeah, now I got super excited about this trip, and he put me on to is a series done by Tyron Martin.
Yeah,
Lost Tracks Atlantic.
Yeah,
and I hadn't seen it before, and oh my word. Did it raise my expectations for Morocco?
Morocco is amazing, man.
Oh, mate, I can't wait. I cannot wait. I'm literally, I mean, this is how tragic I am. I watched that series and I was like, well, I need a mid-length twin fin. I'm making myself a mid-length twin fin for the trip.
It's good when you can do that. Like, oh, what do I need to surf this? Right, I'll just make one of those.
Yeah. As if you know, that's going to make me surf like Tyron Martin.
Oh, of course it will. That's what people come to you for, isn't it? I want the Kelly Slater board because that's how I'm going to surf.
Oh, yeah. It works just like that.
Yeah, of course it does.
Yeah.
So what are you actually going to take? You're going to take the mid-length you made or?
So I'm definitely taking, I've got a performance twin that I've been riding a lot lately, which isn't up on the website yet. But that is just a killer board. I've absolutely been loving that.
Yeah.
So I'll take that for sure as a 6.2. I'm going to take a 6.6 thruster, the mullet model, which works really well for me in bigger swell. Which obviously we're going to have every single day.
And then
I wanted to take sort of a mid-length wild card. So I've got other mid-length options here, but...
Do you have that difficulty as a shaper, which like people have... Like I've got 2, 3, 4, 5 boards, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm going surfing, I'm not sure what it's going to be like. I'm like, what do I take? What do I take?
Mm.
You've got a fucking shop full of them. Do you ever get to that point you just sit and you don't go because you don't know what to take?
No, I always go. I've realized that it's important to limit my choices.
Yeah.
So in my van, I have a dedicated surfboard compartment that only holds 4 boards. So I make the decision before I leave on what options I'm taking.
Yeah.
And I'll, you know, if I'm not sure what conditions are going to do, I'll take a range of boards, everything from, you know, something around the 6.0 mark right up to a log.
Yeah.
So I've got options, but I need to have less to choose from. I think that's the key for me.
Yeah,
less is more. But yeah, I mean, I thought you were going to ask me how many surfboards I have, and
how many surfboards have you got?
It's not important.
More than your wife knows.
It's a bit like guitars. Yeah. Like the key is not to count them. The key is just to hide them in different corners and scatter them around.
Yeah. So. My wife's never been in our loft.
Oh, really?
No.
Well, that's handy, isn't it?
Yeah. What is it? I hope she didn't sell my record collection for what I told her I paid for either.
Oh, terrible. Yeah.
But no,
we definitely don't condone lying to our partners, by the way.
No, not at all. No. Terrible. Unless you're getting something out of it. Anyway, moving on. how many boards, like not shop boards, how many boards have you got yourself then?
So, I don't know. So what I've realized, well, the conclusion I came to anyway, when we were living in Sydney, the conclusion that my wife and I came to is that the correct number of surfboards is 14, because as I was accumulating more boards, I could justify the existence of every single board until I got to number 15.
Yeah.
And because obviously my wife would ask me, you know, why have you got another board? What is that for? And I'd be able to explain every single one of them until number 15. And she sort of said, well, that's it. That's the cutoff. So now you're on one in, one out.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's fair. So 14, you know, is the correct number.
I suppose that range, not being in a funny way, but that range of 14 boards,
mm-hmm.
you've got everything of every shape and size and all tweaks in there. You've probably got, you know, you get to that point where you can't say that because that one does that, and you can't say that because that one does that. So 14 boards. So, you know, if you've got a spare 15 grand or so, someone comes to you, you can get all 14 made and they're set for life. You never need to buy another board.
But see, just doing that, I mean, I understand the maths adds up, but saying it like that, it sounds really bad.
Doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
So if you've got a deposit for a house, come and see Dom and you can get enough boards that you'll never need another one.
Please buy your house before you come and see me. Live responsibly, people.
On that note, do you have anybody that comes in and you're like, mate, stop it?
I'm not going to name names.
No.
But I definitely have customers that are serial board buyers.
Christ.
And I empathize with that, actually. I'm a bit like this with music gear.
Yeah.
And just a little note to my wife, if you're listening, don't. I constantly do it. I constantly buy and sell gear.
You started speaking and realised I just dropped myself right in the shit. Right in the shit. Stop talking.
just for future Pete, that was an edit point.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's staying in.
But I love it. I love buying and selling music gear. I just get it just because I want to try stuff.
Yeah.
And it's the same. I mean, it's the reason why I had 14 boards in Sydney. I just like trying different stuff and seeing what works. And in different conditions, the same board performs completely differently and you sort of unlock something there. And I find the same thing with music gear. I just love it. I buy stuff. I try it. If I like it, I keep it. If I don't, I sell it and buy more stuff.
Do you like more stuff than you don't like?
I mean... I'm a very open-minded person, Pete. That's the thing.
So with that, like with 15 boards, 14 boards then, so do you find you get to a point with, like you were saying, like you couldn't justify more than that?
Mm.
Slightly in a joking way, but slightly, there was a serious point to that as well, which there is actually truth to that.
Yeah.
And do you get to that point of like 14 boards when you get to 15? Actually, I can't justify it because they do the same, to do the same things.
Yeah. And then it's a one in, one out thing, which I think makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
You know. But I mean, obviously I'm not suggesting that every surfer in the world needs 14 boards.
If you're just gonna surf Saunton all the time, you probably need a long board and maybe a mid length for a bigger day if you can get out there in it.
Sure.
But when Saunton's big, it's nails to get out the back anyway.
Yeah, I mean you just gotta find that little rip.
Yeah.
But other than that, it's a right pain. But yeah, I mean, Saunton, if I was only surfing Saunton, I would just surf a log. I don't care how big it gets there. It's perfect for a log.
Yeah.
It's awesome. But yeah, that's the thing. I mean,
and like you just go around the corner to Croydon and Woolacombe.
Right.
You just lose that log. Woolacombe, you can surf a log. Croydon, you probably could. I've seen like Ashley Braunton surf it there. And you know, someone that's like a decent surfer.
Yeah, on the right
but
day. Yeah.
Someone like me going there on a big day on a log, I'm not even going to be getting my feet wet.
Nor me. Yeah. I think the best sessions I've had at Croyd, actually, like when it's properly hammering
were
on mid-lengths.
Yeah.
Yeah, the 2 days I'm thinking of, I was riding two different seven-foot boards, and they both smashed. I had way more fun there than I would have on a short board there.
Yeah.
Just because you could take off a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
And get yourself into position. And yeah, it was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then there's like, you know, I still have to Woolacombe on the weekend.
Cheers for the invite.
Yeah. Anyway. you think you'd get the hint eventually.
Yeah. Could have gone anyway. Didn't want to go anyway.
Well, the thing is, it's funny because we were going to go to Saunton and we saw that you posted you were in Saunton, so we fucked off to Woolacombe.
Yeah. What a prick. Probably, there's probably truth in that as well. It's not because I knew you there on a Friday night, actually.
It's not true. Yeah. I made that up.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of that, why? Because I know Noah got invited.
Well, no. See, Noah invited himself.
Yeah, but you were going to go back to the story about Noah with Ben Gravy.
Is now the time? Yeah,
yeah, now's the time.
Right, so I was on the other side of that transaction. Most of your listeners probably don't know that. I mean, Noah and I are great mates.
Yeah.
And we actually play in a band together.
Yeah. And our band's playing soon.
Yeah, we are.
Where's that?
That is in Bristol.
Yeah.
In St. Nick's Market.
Crown?
I think it's the Crown, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the Crown. So it's on a Sunday night, 2nd of October. I'm guessing actually the episode might be out before then.
Yeah, episode will be out before then. So yeah, if you want to see Dom in Bristol playing in his band.
Mate, come and see us. Like, it'll be good for a giggle if nothing else.
Yeah.
Pete will be there.
All right.
Yeah. Everyone? I invited Pete.
Yeah, I'll be there about as much as you invite me to your surfing trips. Yeah.
Pete will be there for sure. I'll be there. Noah will be there on the drums. He's a brilliant drummer. He's unreal. I mean, he's a terrible human, but he's a really good drummer. Anyway, that night that he went to see Ben Gravy, he got really excited about it. We had a rehearsal booked. And he just didn't show for like 2 hours. He just rocked up 2 hours late. And we were like, what? He's like, guys, Ben Gravy was at the Wave. Obviously, I went to the Wave. Cheers, man.
Didn't tell anybody or anything. Just went. He was so excited when I spoke to him on the
like on Instagram. Candy
he
still.
Was like literally like buzzing his tits off. Oh, my God.
Yeah. He continued to do that for weeks afterwards. Yeah. Yeah.
But he's like a proper Ben Gravy fan as well, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, I think the posters above his bed are a bit weird, but I mean, he's into it, so
whatever turns him on is fine.
No, I mean, he's a massive Ben Gravy fan, and fair play. I mean, Ben Gravy is awesome.
Yeah,
I actually saw him at the Wave when he was here. I couldn't bring myself to approach him because. Well, there's a couple of reasons, actually. One, he was absolutely mobbed by people, and I felt a bit for him. I'm like, I don't need to contribute to that.
Do you know what? That said, he was so nice.
Oh, he seemed lovely, yeah.
Everybody that wanted to have a photo with him, he did. Chat to him, he chatted to them.
Yeah.
And his poor missus is just like, stood there after time like, well, I'm going to go off and do something else, because she's got to be used to it, because he just gets completely mobbed wherever he goes.
Absolutely. But yeah, so... I kind of pulled myself back in that situation, not because I'm not a massive fan. I am. I think he's amazing, but I was just like, I had a little moment of checking myself, and it's a lot to do with the fact that 6 weeks before that, I saw Blair Konkin up there,
yeah,
and I turned into the worst kind of fanboy. Like the worst.
What did you do? Like you can't just leave people on that.
So I'm really embarrassed about it, actually.
Start sniffing them.
No, I was just like, I lost all sense of normality. I'm like, fucking hell, can't be, he's here. Oh my God. And he was like mid-conversation with someone.
Yeah.
And I just like... Right shoved in. Myself in between them, and I was like, "You're Blair." He's like, "Yeah, man, what's up?" I'm like, "I need to shake your hand," and I shook his hand. I was like, "Thanks, man," and I left. Right, and that was it. And he must have thought I was the biggest dickhead ever. And I messaged him on Instagram a couple of hours later, and I'm like, just to apologize. I'm like, "Man, I'm really sorry. I don't normally do that. I'm really embarrassed. I hope you had a good surf at the wave. And he was really kind, and he wrote back to me and he was like, man, it was so great to meet you. Don't worry about it. It happens all the time. Like, so cool to meet you, sort of thing. And I was like,
I think like people do that. My wife did that. I don't know if I've told this story before, but we met Kelly Jones from Stereophonics.
Oh, really?
And she tried to say, she's a massive Stereophonics fan. She tried to say, I'm so glad that you were discovered and people got to hear your music, which is like a decent thing to say to someone who writes good songs.
That's a lovely thing.
What you don't say is, I'm so glad they found you. And he goes, who found me? He's like shitting himself. I haven't let her live it down yet, because she just went, I'm so glad they found you. And he's like, who found me? And like, she was just like, ugh.
Oh, mate, that is brilliant.
It was so funny. I just still rip it out of her every week. Like, just say, oh, I bet they're glad they found him, aren't they? Like, stuff like that. But yeah. Yeah, so I know like people can...
That's really tickled me.
I don't normally get that sort of like fanboy thing with people. Like I can often speak to people just like they're normal people. I got a little bit excited when like we started doing the podcast and I spoke to some people that I thought were like bigger names and stuff like that. But the more you start to speak to these people, the more you realize they're all just normal people. There's anyway. Some people. But but it is funny just to see the way people react. Like, watching Ben Gravy, because we hung around with him for a bit, watching people come up to him and do that sort of thing and just be like, just like, this is weird.
So funny.
But yeah, so the guy was nice to you, in the end?
Awesome. He was bloody lovely.
Yeah.
He's a real gentleman, you know, genuinely nice
That's
guy.
Good.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. Anyway.
So anything else you got planned?
A little bit of stuff,
Anything you want to talk about and let people into a secret yet, or is it still too early?
Well, it is early, so I can't say all of it.
Yeah.
But there's some stuff happening with the business, basically. The last couple of years in Bristol has just been phenomenal. It's been really humbling how quickly... The local surf community has adopted me and supported my business, and it's just incredibly humbling. It's amazing, but it has thrown up some problems, challenges really, just in kind of supplying that demand.
Yes,
as we've spoken about ad nauseum, my delivery times are longer than anyone's comfortable with.
You got that problem though, don't you? Anyone you have working for you, they start shaping and they go and set their own business up doing it. You're like, oh, for fuck's sake.
Well, to be fair, it's not happened yet.
You want to tie people into a contract and say, you come and work for me, you're not allowed to set up anywhere in this area for the next 5 years or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, the challenge I've got here really is that it's just too small a space, and getting commercial space in Bristol is really, really hard. And then there's the fact that I'm geographically removed from the kind of heart of the industry down in Cornwall. So it's hard to get subcontractors in. Well, Devon as well. Yeah. But it's still, no one's going to drive 2 hours each way for a day's work. So, I've got some very understanding customers and very patient customers, but, I'm not happy with the turnaround time on my custom orders. And the other thing that I've sort of realized is that a lot of people are buying my boards because they like the boards, not necessarily because they want a bespoke handcrafted surfboard. So basically, and the other part of this, of course, is that I've had quite a bit of interest from people in Australia about Origin.
I
had a lot of people over there emailing me wanting to know if I can sort of ship from England to Australia, which is so backwards, it's crazy.
Isn't that like the foam sort of comes from shipping it this way and then you're shipping it all the way back?
Well, it's crazy. I mean, half the boards in the UK are built with blanks that are built in Australia. But basically, there's an opportunity there, I think, to offer a product that is available to people off the shelf, where they kind of their origin designs, they kind of come as they come. You know, they come in stock colors or stock colorways, and they come in stock dimensions, and they'll be available for sale in a limited number of retailers in the UK and in Australia. And then there'll be a very, very limited number of hand shapes available each year, maybe 10 or 12 a year.
Yeah.
That are made by yours truly. Yours truly.
So that means the value of your boards are already out there in existence are going to go up in value then, mate, surely.
Going through the roof. Yeah. Don't worry about Bitcoin. Buy Origin Surfboards. Yeah. That's my tip.
Buy Orange Coin. Yeah. I might have to get that black and red one back. Yeah. So, keep hold of that. Paz, keep hold of that. It'll be worth a fortune one day.
He very kindly tagged me in a lovely post about the board.
Yeah. After he loves it, I think.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That made me so happy.
Yeah.
I love finding out where my boards end up. I had an email the other day from a bloke in Taiwan who ended up with one of my origin boards, this 6-0 black fish that I made for a local in Bristol who sold it on, got sold on, and sold it. So it's ended up in Taiwan. He's surfing typhoon swells with it. Amazing. Passing it around all his local mates there, and they all love it. And he wants to know about getting his hands on some origin boards as well. So
amazing. It's funny you should say that. I'll be over that way soon.
I'll
drive fast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's exciting.
So exciting times possibly ahead to see what happens. And I'm sure you'll come back and inform everyone what's gone on when it goes forwards.
When everything's sort of lined up and locked in, I'll definitely let you know. But for the moment, it's still sort of business as usual. Certainly out to the end of the year.
Yeah.
And I'd say if you're on the fence about getting an order in, probably do it sooner rather than later.
Yeah. Yeah, and you're still doing board repairs and everything.
Yeah. Still keeping me busy.
Yeah. It doesn't look like there's that many in.
I was saying earlier, there's about 50 in the workshop at the moment for repair. So
ridiculous. I like that. Looks nice as well. What's that?
Yeah, it's the orange one.
Yeah.
That's an orange one.
All right.
Yeah.
That's nice, man. Yeah. I was just a problem, as I say, coming here. Just, that's nice.
It's so funny. Everyone who walks in does that.
Yeah.
I start browsing through the repair rack. I'm like, they're other people's boards.
Yeah. Let go. Put them down. But yeah, well, cheers for making my new board, man. Once again. I will not give this one away in any raffle or prizes unless something comes and tugs at my heartstrings and then I go, I'll give this one away as well then, shall I?
Mate, chances are if it tugs at your heartstrings, it'll tug at mine as well and I'll be on board.
Nice. But yeah, cheers for taking the time to come back on and chat about the board and what's going on.
Yeah, no worries.
Tell everyone again where they can find you online.
Yeah. You find me on originsurfco.com or on Instagram at origin_surf_co.
Cool.
And I'm looking forward to, going for a surf with you, Pete.
Being invited is a bloody fine thing, isn't it? Yeah. So on that note, unless there's anything else you want to say.
I've missed you, man.
Yeah, I haven't seen you for ages.
Yeah.
You've had COVID about 15 times, haven't you? Yeah. Every time I try and see you, I can't. I've got COVID. Where are you surfing this weekend? No, I can't with you. I've got COVID.
Anyway.
But yeah, cool. All right, man.
Nice one.
Take care of yourselves then and each other. And see you later.
Cheers.
Right, just pulled up at Origin Surfboards to pick up my new board that Dom has made me. Seeing as I gave my old one away in a competition for the last one he made me. Don't know if he's happy about that, but we will find out in just a minute. So head on in, pick this up, see what he's done for me.
Professional in here.
Oh yeah, barking dogs and everything.
Let's say hello to Bailey. Oh, you're tethered. Bailey.
Hi. It's okay. Good girl.
She's a sweetheart, really. She loves me. Bailey.
So, how's it going?
Good.
Been up to anything good?
Sing out, mate. Not much going on, really. Ramo.
So, yeah, pretty much. How did you feel about last time you gave, made me a board and I gave it away?
I have to say it hurt. It hurt a lot. Yeah, it was tough, man. It was tough. It's just that kind of rejection really lingers, you know?
Well, in all honesty, I spoke about you, why I was going to give it away and what happened, and you were like, yeah, do it, man, and we'll make you another one.
So. Mate, absolutely. And like when you told me, it was just such a great cause. I had to get involved, for sure. Yeah. Fully supported.
So, Mr. Origin have made me a new board, and we're going to have a look at what this is like.
Yeah.
New board time.
You always know it's a special day when there's a board covered in slightly damp towels.
Oh, mate. I'm a bit excited.
Are you?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Go on, let's have a look. Let's
Ready?
Have a look. Yeah, go on. Do it.
Whoa.
Yes, this one has a stone under it. Oh, mate, look at that. Look at that. Tidy.
Proper West Country.
Tidy, yeah. Flip them over.
You flip them over?
Yeah.
You haven't seen the bottom.
I haven't seen the bottom at all. Wow, look at that. Dusty. Hey. That's proper nut. Not a bad job.
Thanks,
not a
mate.
Bad job. Awesome. So, what's different on this one? What did we decide?
Well, so this is really a different model to the last one I gave you. This is one of the very first of a new model called the Transatlantic. And this one, where the Cali Cut was about kind of taking a really old school design and making it quite modern,
yeah,
surf more progressively, this is about keeping it really traditional.
Yeah.
So got some feedback off you from your last board, and we sort of decided that, you know, we wanted to get a bit more volume into it for you, get something that works really, really nice and trim, nose rides really well, and this will do it. So, basically, yeah, it's 9'4", 3 inches thick, 23 inches wide, so there's a heap of foam there. Really kind of classic roll bottom board with a bit of E through the tail, bit of concave through the nose, quite a moderate rocker. The sort of thing that you'll need to cross step to turn really sharp with, but it's also, you know, super early takeoff, easy to paddle. Really cruisy, trim down the line, should be able to get up on the nose, no problem. Yeah, that's it, Transatlantic.
Yeah, so on this one, like the things I found difficult with the other ones, I mean the board itself, everyone that rode the other one,
yeah,
has absolutely loved it.
Yeah.
For myself, I found it to be, when I got into the wave, it was brilliant. It just locked straight into the wave, really good.
Yeah.
But when I was paddling for the wave, I wasn't catching as many waves on that as I would on my other board, which, yeah, I think is to do with, well, the amount, it might have just been the amount of volume in it.
I think volume would have been a big part of it. Yeah, so I mean, off the initial consult that we did with you and Leighton, you know, we decided to tweak yours to be a little bit more progressive.
Yeah.
And you know, it can be like that with surfboards, because the way you're describing this stuff is all relative to the experience that you've had and the things you've been riding already, and
yeah,
that could be different to everyone else's experience. So
yes, because my board I was riding already,
mm,
was the dimensions were more or less exactly the same as that.
The overall dimensions, yeah.
Yeah.
I reckon, but the literage
was
through the roof. When I saw that,
yeah,
that thing's a bloody tanker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's that? There's a hole in it.
There's a hole. Yeah, yeah. It's a speed hole. Yeah. No, it's not really. I really like doing this on on boards with single fin boxes. It's sort of an old school way of attaching a leash loop. So it's called a drill through loophole. And basically you feed through the loop for your leg rope, yeah. Your leash, sorry.
Yeah.
Through the fin box in the bottom, and it pops out the top, and then you connect your leash to it.
Oh, nice.
So it's just kind of really streamlined and quite pretty. It's a little bit more work, but I like it.
It's nice. So yeah, I've not seen, you don't often see them on like UK boards, to be honest. There's normally just something on top, something else that can rip out on top.
Well, yeah, I mean, plugs are really easy to sort of fit, and they're great, they work fine. You know, it's just sort of a personal preference thing, but I do quite like it on really classic boards like this, where it's just really low key.
Yeah.
It's purely aesthetic. It just looks
nice. That's the one I surf it, leashless, isn't it, you know?
Yeah. Public safety announcement.
Pete, leashless Pete is not going to go down well. This is really nice though, man. You've done a really good job on this.
Thanks, mate.
Plus I've got grips to go all over it.
Have you?
Which is the pads to go all over it.
What have you got?
It's called Surf Gripped.
Okay.
It's a new one. Mitch has recommended it to me actually, and he's been using it. He's put it on all his boards now, and he's been surfing it for like about 6 months or so.
Okay.
And they're not abrasive on your wetsuits or anything, like other ones like sandpaper. These are more like, they feel like gel pads. And when he was at the Wave, he switched boards with Ben Gravy, and Ben said he didn't even notice that there was pads on there. So, I mean, if that's not a good...
That's a good endorsement.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've not seen them.
Yeah. Yeah, really good, apparently. So this is going to get covered in it. And then we'll go from there. So, it only took about a week for this to be done, didn't it?
A week, and then the 8 months before that. Yeah, you've been a very patient man, Pete.
Yeah, nice of you to do it for free, seeing as I had to wait so long.
Yeah, I mean, we don't use the F word in this building.
Mate, it's so nice. It's like, it's really nice. I like the little chop. So this is we went from 9.4,
23x3.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Little bit of a chop on the tail, not too much, which is what I asked for.
Mm-hmm.
And then, it's just an absolute thing of beauty. You did a good job again. Like, I'm surprised you did a good job like after last time.
Thanks, mate.
So yeah.
Nice. I look forward to hearing the ride report.
Oh, it's going to be great. Looks like there's surf on Sunday as well, so hopefully might be going.
Maybe have a little session together.
Yeah.
I did promise my wife that we'd be working on the house this weekend, but...
Maybe not.